the students and the parents feel that this year there is everybody is moving into mechanical, electrical, civil, the traditional branches, because they perceive that there are more job opportunities in those branches. 5 years back, the paradigm was exactly reversed. Everybody thought computer science, IT, electronics would find them good jobs. So we had a proposition from institutions who kept saying that we will close mechanical, electrical, civil, you convert that to computers, all that. 5 years going forward, the same guys are coming back and saying that we want mechanical, we want civil, we want electrical. Now there is a point here to be seen. Suppose, as an argument, I convert all of the seats where the people are asking for conversion to be converted to civil, mechanical and electrical. I will bet that the vacancy position will come down, because there are students. It's not that we don't have students. The students are there, but they do not want the kind of branches that are left over. Okay, so they would probably get into the system if they got a seat in mechanical, electrical, civil, because they perceive that that as the best means to go forward. Now, taking on from that, if I convert all of them, obviously my vacancy numbers will come down. There is a problem with quality in colleges, and some colleges will not get students, whatever you do, that is all going to be there. But the vacancy position will come down. But what is it going to lead to? I'll get more mechanical engineers into the system. I'll get more electrical guys, more civil guys, and so on. Now, is that the way we want to grow our technical education? This will lead to a lopsided growth. And tomorrow you will suddenly find that, why did you produce all those mechanical engineers? They are not finding jobs. Obviously, they don't find jobs because your demand side, your employment potential is not growing at that rate. You need to intervene at that place, create more job opportunities at different levels, do a massive investment into industry, and set up that condition, that value there. Then what will happen is that will drive the requirement of engineers, and therefore which will drive the education side and the downstream activities. I can't possibly say that because I do not have the enough job opportunities, I will not let these guys study. You know, this is one side of the problem about vacancies that you said. The second point here is, you cannot have quality end to end. Okay, if I create 100 institutions, all 100 institutions will be equally good is a very short-sighted argument to make, or even to think that I'll make them all good is not going to happen. If that were the proposition, today we should have more than 100 IITs which are doing extremely well, competing with each other and be in the global market space. That doesn't happen. So therefore, quality comes at a premium. In order to set up a quality institution, it takes a lot of money, it takes a lot of time. Most of the good institutions, you talk about Imperial, you talk about Stanford or an MIT or whatever, they took more than 150 years to really come in as a good institution. And today people talk about that. We are not anywhere near that. For example, your Harvard has 24% of their revenue generated through publishing. You give me one institution in India which generates its revenue through publishing. Now, most of the institutions here survive on tuition fees. Now, if the tuition fees is going to cater to 80%, 90% of your salary requirements of your institution, then obviously you can't go beyond a point in raising the tuition fees. And the second point is, where is the money left over for development? So therefore, many of our institutions will operate only at a certain level. In order to move them out from that level, you need a lot of inputs, you need a lot of good faculty, which means you have to invest a lot of money. Now that can come in some of the private sectors where the bearings are in the right place, or it can come through the government intervention, which is happening in our IITs and so on, but that's a very small scale for such a large country. Looking at all this, the student also sees where is my best possibility in getting a meaningful job, what should I do? Now, instead of going for a institution which is bad, I'll rather do something else. So therefore, the only thing that will prevail is, if you have quality, you will survive. If you do not have quality, you will perish. That is the future. Don't say that protection has to be given to existing institutions by not allowing new institutions to come in, because the existing institutions are not able to get students. I mean, it's not the job of a university or a regulator to find students for a college. If you have a good college, people will come. If Delhi University, not a single seat goes vacant. Why is it so? Because they have developed a reputation over a period of time. If I have a good institution in Mumbai, which is let's say VGTI, the reputation has come from years of toil. So no seat will go vacant there, come what may. So therefore, you have to put in systems within an institution to create that. Today, it is always good to increase the supply than the demand. Quality will always come in, always set in. See, accreditation is a very good method of rating institutions. I would look at it in two different ways. First of all, we have several colleges in each state, and we have several students applying, vying for them. And most of the states have a common admission methodology. They go through some test, some entrance test. Then they create a common merit list. And then they allot students based on their preference. Now, within the student community, there is an extremely good perception based on very strong value systems, very strong analysis as to which institution is good, which is the next one, which is the next one, and so on. And they even know by courses which the institutions run, except probably the last 20%, 25% of the students in that list who anyway have no choice, right? Now, all these students, when they are applying and when they are seeking admission, they go through a certain list which they perceive as the best list. I believe, with all my experience, that's the best list you can ever have. And therefore, students provide you the best accreditation method that you can ever have. They will rate your institutions, they will rate your courses in the order in which no methodology can ever replicate. This is one way which is happening today. Yes, the underlying assumption is that there is a fair process of admission in this category. No lateral intrusions happen. Having said this, there is a second methodology which we are seeing today, that of measuring the outcomes. As a purely accreditation process, our private institution started growing somewhere in 82-83, and today we have several of them all over the country. When we started off, we looked at measuring the basic requirements: how many classrooms, how many faculty, how many what facilities, what administrative facilities, what teaching facilities, and all that. These are all inputs necessary to run an institution. They by themselves do not prove anything. They are the bare minimum that is required. But our earlier accreditation process essentially used to provide a large percentage of marks for that availability. So it was a more of an input based system. Over a period of time, people realized that this is anyway essential. So you don't need those to measure those things. They are, if there is no bench, why do you cut marks or add marks? I mean, that is meaningless. What you really need to do is, if there is a mechanical engineering course, and if a student is expected to know so and so as the values that he has learned through his 4 years of education, then has he really got that knowledge? If he goes through a course in thermal engineering, does he understand thermal engineering? Can he apply thermal engineering to to problem solving, and what extent of expertise does he have in those chosen areas. Now, the new accreditation method precisely tries to do that. So, this is a more of a closed loop system. The earlier one was an open loop accreditation system. Open loop meaning you give inputs, you expect that something good should happen, and there is no measurement mechanism. So, you assume that it has happened. Now, in the new system, you actually know what you expect of a student, of a faculty, of an infrastructure, and so on. Now, you create systems, we have created systems in which you precisely measure the outcomes. If a student goes through a course in electrical engineering, does he understand Kirchhoff's laws? Can he use Kirchhoff's laws and things like that? So those outcomes are measured today, but it stops at that point of time. For a process to be truly closed loop, the error that you observe when you measure an outcome, you expect some outcome, you don't get that outcome, you find that students are lagging in so and so, so and so, so and so. So you measure that error in the outcome. That error should go through the second cycle, added to the input, and then the cycle flows again. So therefore, in the second cycle, the error reduces. Therefore, if over a period of 4 or 5 years, you come to a stabilized system where the outcomes are as expected. Now, that is what we are moving to, but there is a step beyond this. Even in a fully closed loop system, what happens is the time to stabilize will be very, very large, because it's adding, finding out error, adding to the cycle again is a very tedious process. It's a very involved process. It's not easily done. So therefore, it will take time to stabilize. So what, and the drawback of that system is the error flows through all the system parameters. It flows through student, it flows through faculty, it flows through all the parameters that are there to define quality. Which means that if there is a certain element in this chain which is not actually contributing to error, then this addition of error at the input side will actually make that go wrong. So this will take a long time. In future, we believe the entire accreditation process should go through an adaptive mode of accreditation, which means that you define what is the outcome of a student, what is the input given to a student, what is the process. Similarly, you do for faculty, similarly you do for infrastructure, similarly you do for the industry interface, for research, for placements and all that. And at each of those parameters, you create a closed loop. Then this time to stability will be very, very small, and your accreditation will be probably the best in the world. The NAC is essentially for institutions other than technical education. NBA is National Board of Accreditation for technical education as defined under the AICTE Act. So it applies for engineering, it applies for architecture, pharmacy, applied arts, management, all that. NARA is an authority to be set in motion, which defines the preliminaries for an accreditation body to function. So, since our system is very large, we require several accreditation bodies. One NAC will not be able to accredit 35,000 colleges. One NBA cannot accredit 12,000 colleges and 60,000 programs at UG level, PG level, diploma, and so on. So you need multiple bodies. When there are multiple bodies, there is a problem of standardization. What are the methodologies that are used within those multiple bodies, and how do you give a value to the certification that is given by these various bodies? So NARA is an authority which will set the standards for these multiple bodies so that they function within a framework, and too much of variation, subjectivity, they don't happen. That's the issue. NARA will be a policy body which will determine the standards for these accreditation bodies to follow, so that standard practices can be employed, best practices can be done, and so on. Now, earlier we were in a process of evolution. Like I said, the early time that I joined was very, very turbulent. Later on, we realized that the good players should be coming into the system. And one of the large section of those good players would be the industry. Now, in order to set up an institution, the earlier rule was you have to set up a society or a trust, and that's it. But which means that essentially the industry is out of the game. So we wanted to see that the industry actually owns up. Instead of sitting outside and saying that my engineer is not employable, why don't you come in into the system? You set up an institution, we'll provide you the enabling mechanism, and you produce people who would have quality. I mean, that's the best way to operate. Or you adopt our institutions. Now, this will mean that the entire structure will have to be changed. So we brought in Section 25 in 2012-13 for the first time, and we just got four applications, and they were reasonably good industries. And later on, we found another problem area, which I described earlier, that of private lease. So industries have land, but they cannot come into the picture because we give only government lease. So therefore, now we have changed even that. A private lease also would be possible along with Section 25. So the government, the industry can turn over its excess land to a private lease to a trust or a society or a Section 25 company and set up an institution. So we have made reasonable amendments to the regulations that are in place, and somehow we want to see that the best of the industry comes into education. Because technical education is so closely linked with the requirements of an industry. Neither the industry will grow nor the education will grow if they remain apart. See, National Vocational Education Qualification Framework, which the MHRD had notified in September 2012, has been working fine. About 2 months back, National Skill Qualification Framework has been as a Government of India initiative. So what we were doing under NVEQF, we will be doing under NSQF. And our motto is very, very simple. The merely skills given in an ITI or elsewhere is terminal in nature, which means if I'm trained to become a welder, I remain forever a welder unless I retrain myself for some higher order skills. So therefore, the number who get into ITIs is very limited. So a large scale expansion doesn't happen there. On the other hand, a conventional degree or a diploma doesn't guarantee you any job. So therefore, what you require is a new paradigm. The 25 million dropping out is something that I have already told you. So suppose all the 40,000 colleges that we have, 12,000 colleges in the technical education sector, the others in the other higher education sector, if each of those colleges conduct 500 students in flexible times towards the evening. Most of the colleges do nothing after 5 o'clock. They just lock up and go. It's a huge waste of infrastructure. It's a huge waste of locking in precious resources. So I don't think we need to create any brick and mortar new thing. These 40,000 colleges can be optimally utilized to run 7 certificate levels. The first certificate level starting at 9th standard. 10th is the second certificate, 11th, 12th, 13th, 14th, 15th. The first 5 certificates leading to a diploma in vocational education. The 7 certificates leading to a degree in vocational education. And with the choice to a student that he or she can drop out at any after any certification level and find an appropriate job or move into the conventional higher education system if he or she desires. Now this provides multiple pathways, opportunities, even for a person who has completed maybe his 12th in 2005 and has been working in some automobile company and not progressed further, can come down and move into this framework, because he has a level 4 certificate for education, all that he has to do is go to a trainer, get his skills assessed, and if he gets a level 4 skill certification, he moves into a level 5 certification, and after 1 year he gets a diploma in vocational education. So these are extremely good initiatives that are happening. And for all those students who have never gone to school, 8th fail and below, we have what we have done is given all those skills, as we do in the framework, all those skills are given to these people who have never gone to school either, and the skills will be the same. And as far as the education part is concerned, we don't teach them the conventional education, not a degree, not for a degree, not for a diploma, but we give them a community skill diploma by teaching them 1500 hours of communication English, another language other than their mother tongue, so that the mobility increases. And we also give them a basic accounting skills so that he can do some entrepreneurial initiatives, and personality grooming skills. So we have covered end to end. All those people who have never gone to school, never gone to college, they also get skills in different sectors, different specializations. And those who want to make career, vocational education as a career, they also have a path. And people who want to move out from vocational to formal, formal to vocational, vocational to job market to vocational, formal, everything is possible in the new framework. And we have actually funded 100 colleges. What we are saying is that any college, my polytechnic or degree college or any other college, which runs this framework will be called a community college. So therefore, community college becomes a vehicle. NVQF or NSQF becomes the framework, infrastructure and recurring expenses to run these skill-based programs in 100 polytechnics, 1 to 1.5 crore rupees we have given each college. We have about today 100 skill provider trainers who are listed on our portal. Besides this, we have all the 600 trainers of ILFS. We have got a MOU done with them. We are talking to NIIT and APTEC to use their roughly 600 trainers in the IT sector. And we have also got into an MOU with an ILET under Department of IT to use their training centers. We have also converted their courses into NVQF qualifications. So a lot of things are happening which we hope will push this education sector into a much more dynamic environment. We are into several development initiatives. First of all, I don't accept that it has an advisory role, because the advisory part of the judgment is an observation in the judgment. It's not a part of the order. The second point is, it still has a regulatory role. The Section 23 of the Act gives the power to AICTE to create regulations for maintaining standards and so on. So that being what it is, we are pushing several initiatives. Recently we have funded almost 75 colleges to create hostels for underprivileged students. We gave 2 crore rupees to each of the colleges. Then we have started a research park proposal, where we have approved 4 colleges. We have given the money as well. The proposal is they provide 2,000 square feet to set up an extension arm within their institution to an industry of their choice. We give 1 crore rupees, and they provided the industry pitches in with 1 crore rupees. So there is a 2 crore corpus which is created in the beginning to start the process. Start the activity. We have funded 4 such colleges. We have many more in process. Then we have also started what is called as innovation, student innovation proposal, where we will be conducting a fair for students with certain themes, based on requirements of the MSME, and there will be a 1-day program starting 8 in the morning, closing next day 8 in the morning, and we will have 10,000 students participate in creating new ideas, innovations and so on. They will be evaluated by a group of experts, and 250 best projects will be selected from them, and all each one of those 250 will be funded to move into the next level of productization and so on. So there are several initiatives which we are doing to improve quality, to improve. We have also got into an MOU with UKERI, British Council, and we are funding 250 delegates for leadership programs in UK and so on. This will help the vocational education, the skill building activities and so on. We also have an MOU with American Association for Community Colleges. So we will be getting another 35 colleges to collaborate with them. So all these things are happening. One other thing is we have given we have created a new regulation, two regulations in fact. One is on National Employability Enhancement Mission. We call it NEEM. Under this regulation, anybody with a certain criteria can be registered as a training provider, and they pick up my graduate students or my diploma students or students from other colleges in different sectors and place them in the industry for training, and thereby increasing their employability potential and so on. They also get some stipend and so on. Today you have a apprenticeship scheme, but that has inherent limitations and so on. So NEEM is expected to provide a free and fair play for people to get into industries easily in chosen areas, get training. This training will be from 2 months to 24 month period depending on sector specialization and so on. The other one is we have also given a regulation for conducting certain technical education programs through distance learning, use of MOOCs, and some of the initiatives that different institutions have been pioneering. And we hope all this will add to that quality proposition that we are making. I would want to make a sincere appeal to all of them who are listening to this, the society, the judiciary, the government, almost everybody, whoever is a stakeholder in this whole process, to see that bodies like AICTE are strengthened, they function as per the deliverables in respect to their various acts, and they continue to do the good work. By all means, pull them up when they don't deliver, but making them redundant is no solution.